Assalamu alaikum. Greetings and welcome to the Munir Muhammad Show. I'm your host, Jamil Muhammad. Brothers and sisters, we have an exciting show for you today. But before I introduce our guests, I'd like to remind you, as always, to please follow us on our social media platforms, which include Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please go to our YouTube page, click the like, the subscribe, and the notification buttons so you can be notified whenever we post a show. Brothers and sisters, I'm very excited about our guest today, especially in these trying times right now. This will be a timely interview with our friend and brother. He is the founder and master instructor at Martial Arts World.
Yes, sir.
Our brother Lemuel Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum, brother.
Alaikum
salam. It's okay.
Shaking. Yes, sir.
Thank you for having me, brother. Thank you, brother. I stress how timely this show is, especially for our people as we, see the narrative. There's so much going on in the world today. And you know that self-defense, discipline, those things are key and essential, you know, as Muslim followers of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad anyway, but equally as important for our people as we navigate today. And so I thank you for joining us to share information.
Thank you for having me, brother.
Yes, sir. And I'll begin by opening it up to you, brother, so you could tell us a little bit about yourself, including about your school.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum, brother.
Well, excellent.
And I want to thank you all for having me on your show. I did not know what to expect, but I feel so warm and so welcome right now.
Yes,
my name is Lemuel Muhammad. I am the founder of Martial Arts World. I am the chief instructor of the school. And at this time, I hold the rank of 6th degree black belt in VSK Jiu-Jitsu under Grandmaster Abdulaziz Muhammad. And I wear the title Shihan.
Yes, sir. All praises due to Allah, brother. 6 degrees, black belt, right?
Yes, so, sir.
For our viewing audience, how many degrees are there?
Well, in our system, in traditionally martial arts, there are 10 degrees.
Okay, that's it.
So you go first through 10th. And I've been blessed to make it to 6th degree, and I'm very, very happy.
I have to ask you, how long have you been training, brother?
37 years. Mm-hmm. 37 years. I've been training since I was 14 years old. I've had 3 instructors totally. My first instructor when I was 14. I had another instructor at the age of 20. Mm-hmm. And my master now, Grandmaster Abdulaziz Muhammad.
Okay. And no, could you kind of give us a breakdown? You study in jiu-jitsu, is that correct?
VSK jiu-jitsu, exactly.
And describe that style of martial arts.
Well, VSK Jiu-Jitsu is a combination of 3 independent martial arts systems,
okay,
where you have Vijitsute, which is the V, mm-hmm, you have Sanukis-ryu, which is the S, mm-hmm, and Kumite-ryu Jiu-Jitsu, which is the K. They are all independent martial arts or Jiu-Jitsu systems that my teacher, Grandmaster Abdulaziz Muhammad, trained in with those founders directly.
Okay.
And so to pay homage and respect to all of his instructors, he decided to call what he does VSK Jiu-Jitsu. And since I'm a product of what he does, mm-hmm, I train in VSK Jiu-Jitsu.
Yes, sir. Go back to when you were 14, brother. What, how did you become interested in martial arts?
Like most, mm-hmm, I saw Bruce Lee, you know, and so I was, being a small boy, I was very, very small, mm-hmm, most of my life growing up.
Yes, sir.
I was very short, and so I saw him, was very impressed with his speed, his power, you know, his presentation. He always played the underdog kind of guy in the strange land, that kind of thing. So that kind of appealed to me.
Yes, sir.
And I just started kicking and punching around the house, and my mom, we were too poor to afford actual formal instructions.
Yes, sir.
And so when I was around 13, 14 years old, my mom met a instructor, his name was Sensei Gregory Myrick, mm-hmm, and he was willing to teach me. Mm-hmm. And my agreement was is that I had to show up early to clean up the school, and I had to stay late to clean up the school.
Yes, sir.
And that's how I paid for my lessons.
You know, but you stuck with it, because I think many of us, when we were young, you know, we had we could get the karate shoes, we cut the brooms to make, things like that. But you took to it and you stuck to it.
Well, you know, I got to say this. I have to say my teacher, yes, Grandmaster Abdulaziz Muhammad, is mostly the reason why I stuck to it, because he took what I already had and made it better. And then he gave me a different idea, and he actually made me fall in love with the idea of being an instructor. I always wanted to be a practitioner.
Yes, sir.
But he made me fall in love with being an instructor, you know, through his example as an instructor and running a school. I never wanted to ever run a school. That was not, I just wanted to fight. I wanted to do that part of it, but he showed me the value in sharing with others. Mm-hmm. And as a member of the FOI, it was very, very good for him to be an FOI, because, you know, we have a code of conduct, and yes, I was already in that code. And so, Brother Jamil, I actually resigned as I was a lieutenant at the time in FOI.
Yes, sir.
And I resigned as a lieutenant to become his apprentice so I could have the information that he had as the master. I could get it so that there would be more than one person in the Nation of Islam with that information.
Yes, sir. Our praise is due to Allah. You know, talk about just adopting the change in mindset, a mentality to be an instructor versus just a student and training.
Yes, sir. Well, you know, that mindset, that's a very, very good question, because it is selfish to only want to be a practitioner, but yes, it's sir. Not selfishness to only want to be a practitioner. You yes, know, sir. I, you know, if you say, I just want to be a fighter, I never want to coach other people, there's nothing wrong with that.
Yes, sir.
So the transition or the paradigm shift for me was I felt love for my teacher, and I felt love for my teacher. And the love and the adoration that students had for the teacher, you know, a lot of us in the black community, we grew up not having a father figure or a father in the home present. I grew up in under those circumstances. And so that feeling of love that you get from your students, that, you know, that's kind of intoxicating. It can be anyway.
Yes, sir.
And people look up to you and they make you feel good about being an instructor. And then it gives you, you know, a level of standard that you have to begin to, you know, operate in. Right. Or operate from as an instructor, because people look up to you, and if you do anything that's detracting from that, you know, you can really ill affect people for like a long time, because it's real easy for people to set up, you know, gods besides Allah.
Yes, sir.
And so it comes with a responsibility. I think that's what I'm really trying to say. Well, I was ready to accept the responsibility of striving to be a good example and not just a good fighter.
Yeah. You know, I was going to ask you, and I still will, how martial arts has impacted your life. When I listen to you, I think of, we have a brother named Sharif Muhammad, who is an instructor of Aikido.
Good friend of mine.
One of the most humble, gracious brothers that I know. And I've often heard him say that the discipline that's required and the responsibility, as you said, helps him not only in the teachings but in life to kind of walk in that path consistently. And so I'll ask you, you know, how has it impacted your life? And you've been studying for a long time, so I'm sure there are many stages that you can go to, but what has it meant to you?
You know, I think that the impact of martial arts in my life really, I'm just now learning this, Brother Jamil, that there's no separation between my Islam and my martial arts.
Yes,
I never understood why my teacher's integration of the two was so deep.
Yes, sir.
But now I kind of understand it a little bit more. And so the impact of martial arts was mostly transformative for me because of the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Mm-hmm. Under the armaments of Louis Farrakhan, as one of, you know, the members of the Nation of Islam, the discipline, the focus, the respect, the yes sir, the no sir, all of the post holding, all of the traveling with the armaments of Louis Farrakhan, but the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad is what really helped me to take my martial arts to a whole nother level.
Yes, sir.
Because, you know, without the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, his example and his minister to us, I'm a Minister Louis Farrakhan, I would probably not even know how to do for self. Mm-hmm. It would be something that's out there, but it wouldn't be something that maybe I feel I could attain because I grew up very, very poor and not around a lot of great examples of men who were doing stuff.
Right.
You know, so when I met the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan and my teacher, this whole other world, even when I met your father, he was so gracious and so warm, and everybody around the teaching of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad were very productive people.
Yes, sir.
And so the martial arts and the Islam produced in me a desire to want to do something.
Yes, sir.
And so that's how the school was born.
Okay. And speaking of the school, where is it? What's the name? Where's the name of the dojo and the location again?
The name of our school is Martial Arts World, and we are located 16709 Torrance Avenue, and that's in Lansing, Illinois.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're familiar with Lansing, we are located in a mall.
Yes, sir.
Called Landings Mall. We share the space with FedEx Office, Chase Bank, and some other places.
Yes, sir.
We're actually in a space that used to be Pier 1 Imports.
Okay, yes, sir. Now, I will ask you this. I know that you started at 14, but what are the age ranges of some of the students that attend?
Wow. You know, on our paperwork, as long as you are age 4, we will accept you.
Yes, sir.
But a few years ago, back I believe in 2016, I wish I could remember the brother's name, 89 years old and decided to join the dojo.
Yeah.
He never boxed, wrestled, he never did any fight training, and he decided to join our school and learn jiu-jitsu at 89 years old.
Wow.
So we're open to anyone who wants to learn, but the minimum age requirement to join our school is 4 years old.
Well, I have to say in the viewing audience, brothers, is that if a brother's 89 years old, there are no excuses. There are no excuses. But speaking of that, many times people will see the show. They'll have the idea. You know, that sounds good. I want to do that. What, being an instructor, seeing first-time students, what are some of the obstacles or things that you see some students, they have apprehensions about training that you, if you were talking to someone in our audience, that you would tell them to kind of try to get over or don't be so nervous about?
Well, you know, I think the biggest apprehension or drawback to people getting started is fear. You know, people are afraid they're going to get hurt.
Yes,
like
sir.
With you and I,
yes, sir.
Like if we have children, we feel like, okay, it's an activity for them, right?
Right.
And you may want your son to learn, you know, martial arts, or your daughter to learn martial arts for discipline and self-defense.
Right.
But you, as a working adult, you may say, man, if I get hurt, I can't afford to get hurt. I can't miss work. And then, you know, so you're a little apprehensive about you don't want to get hurt. And, but my teacher would say, you know, like I asked him before, I say, Grandmaster, what would you say is the most common excuse? We use the word excuse.
Yes, sir.
For people not joining martial arts. And he said, all excuses are common. And so So now I understood because, you know, it's so easy, you know, today, you know, we're in a right now kind of society. Everybody wants to know everything right now.
Right.
They, you know, that's why social media is so big. You know,
yes,
you go live. You know, if you got 6 million people and you go live on something, 6 million people get hit that you're doing this right now.
Right.
And, you know, everybody's like this, like voyeur, like watching everything.
Right, right.
And so it's difficult for people to navigate all of the distractions because martial arts requires discipline, requires focus, because you're teaching people how to do things that harm human beings. And if you're not paying attention, you know, accidents happen and, you know, so people don't want to get hurt.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it's the money.
Yes, sir.
Sometimes it's the commitment of time. You know, maybe the school is not open offering classes at the time you get off work.
Right.
You know, but I believe that those are all excuses and they're all common, as
yes,
my
sir.
Teacher would say, because if where there's a will, there's a way. The Honorable Louis Farrakhan would say, desire feeds the will. So if you desire a thing hard enough, then you will find a way to do it. And that's why we introduced, you know, during this time with COVID, you know, martialartsworldonline.com.
Yeah, and I was going to ask you how, because of course you need a certain amount of engagement, but how did the COVID pandemic affect the dojo? And did you, you know, how did you pivot? But you mentioned online, so talk more about that.
Well, I'm going to say this. First, about COVID, it hit us. We didn't know what it was.
Right.
And when the governor said gyms and, you know, businesses within our type of category had to shut down, like, literally completely, it was scary because, Brother Jamil, I have actually, I'm not, like, I don't work at, like, a Chase Bank or someplace else and then teach in the evening. I'm a career martial artist. I've written 2 books on the system. I produce a plethora of training materials and DVDs, and I'm all in. Like, I teach martial arts all day. I just left the training someplace and come to your show. And after I leave here, I got to go back to dojo because we're gearing up for a big competition at the end of the month. And so the COVID shutting down, I didn't understand it. So we first pivoted to Zoom.
Yes, sir.
Some people don't like that, you know, it's, you know, the not the connection.
Right,
you know, we have a connect. It's not like we're doing Tai Chi, you know, where you can just do it on your own, right?
Yes, sir.
We're doing something where you learn why, you know, by interacting with other people. So we did the Zoom. We lost some people. Mm-hmm. And I was most concerned about my rent. Because we had to pay rent.
Yes, sir.
And the management company, the owners of our of the mall, they still wanted their money. So I was very grateful that we qualified for PPP. Mm-hmm. We were able to get something to keep things going. And yes, sir. And that's and so we didn't actually pivot to Martial Arts World Online until, I don't know, I had a late epiphany.
Yes, sir.
Year. And I said, I'm going to do this, and this is how I'm going to do it, and I'm going to have it ready by this date, and that's what we're doing right now.
And how have the people responded to that, brother?
Well, brother, I if I quit, if I give up, then maybe only 1 or 2 people have responded.
Yes, sir.
So I'm looking at the 1 or 2 people who have responded and saying, somebody else wants it. I just got to get the information in front of enough people, you know, enough times for them to buy into what it is that we're offering
and
know that what we're offering is not, we're not offering a Big Mac. Like, we're not on every corner. What we what we teach is not on every corner in the city or in different neighborhoods. Like, there may be hundreds of karate schools, hundreds.
Yes, sir.
But there is not but one, actually 2 VSK Jiu-Jitsu schools in Illinois.
And talk about what makes that special, because that's why I want this thing, you know, because, you know, our people sometimes, we're not good at making distinctions sometimes, you know, everything, you know, is the same, but, you know, make the distinction of what's special about martial arts world and the VSK Jiu-Jitsu that you teach.
Well, you know, the first thing is that 2 of the 3 founders are black men.
Yes, sir.
And my teacher is also a black man. And so this art, one of my old brothers, he's passed on now, his name is Brother Fred Muhammad.
Yes, sir.
He said that, and I don't know how true it is, but I love the statement. It just made me train harder. But he said that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said that the 2 martial arts for the black man was Aikido and Jiu-Jitsu. I don't know how true that is, but him just saying that as an older brother, I said, okay, cool, I explored that. So Jiu-Jitsu in and of itself is already a great martial art. But coming out of the mind of Dr. Moses Powell, who is known in the Nation of Islam as Musa Muhammad, who was a great, great Muslim and teacher of the martial arts, that made it more valuable for me. So my love affair with Bruce Lee and what he did was, you know, kind of swayed over to Dr. Moses Powell and what he brought and how great he was and is. You know, what he taught, He's one of those black men who's the first. He was the first black man to teach the fighting arts to the United States Secret Service, DEA, FBI, like these government law enforcement branches, right? What's really important to know is that his systems and what he taught is still taught in their training academy to this day. And I know that because they made the mistake of trying to approach me once, and they tipped their hand and they let me know that that what he taught or taught them is still being taught in their training academy. So that's also special about VSK Jiu-Jitsu because the central system, which is Sanukis, is still being taught to the highest law enforcement agency in the world. That separates us from everyone else.
Well said. Well, on that note, brother, we're going to take a break, okay? All right. Brothers, we're going to take a quick break, and we're going to come back with more interesting conversation. We'll be right back.
You are watching The Muneer Muhammad Show, a production of Crow. Please take time to join us at Crow, the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Crow is the National Archive of the Nation of Islam and houses one of the largest collections of historical audio, video, and print documentation on the total black experience. Crow is located at 2435 West 71st Street, the corner of 71st and Crow Lane. We are open 7 days a week, 9 to 5. Our number, 773-925-1600. We look forward to seeing you at Crow.
Eat and Run Chicken and Fish has the only chicken you can reheat and eat. It's good as mother's and better than the others. It is the chicken even mothers love. We've been serving the community for over 30 years. We cook with 100% vegetable oil and are open 7 days a week, including holidays. We're located at 87th and Hermitage. Contact us at 773-429-1812 for your takeout order, or let us provide all your catering needs. For the best chicken of your life, it's Eat and Run.
This portion of the Muneer Muhammad Show is brought to you by East Lake Management, innovative solutions for building communities of the future today.
Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. We are back continuing our conversation with our brother, Lemuel Muhammad. Brother, I don't want them to think everything is real, you know, so I want them to know that there are costs associated with the classes and training. And so I'll start with the online training.
Yes,
and
sir.
What could you kind of share, like the cost structure of that or some of the classes?
Yes, sir. Well, martialartsworldonline.com offers you 5 different tiers of training levels. But we help you, we walk you in, we hold your hand because we give you a 3-day free trial.
Okay.
And you have access to 34 individual trainings that you can, you know, check out, you know, for 3 days at no obligation. If at the end of those 3 days you think that this is not for you or you don't want to go any further, you just cancel your subscription. You know, it's really just that simple. It ranges from $29.99 a month up to $119.99 a month. And the top tier obviously offers, you know, a couple of live trainings with me, directly with me. From anywhere in the world where you are, you can train. I'll come right into your living room, your office, wherever you are, and I'll be working with you, you know, live. That's the online platform. Yes, and that's, we know that we need to shift there because of COVID and other concerns that people have. You know, people get shut into their homes, right. You know, again, they're going to need something to do, and they're going to need to know how to fight because it looks like that's the direction of the society.
Yeah. You know, and one of the things I would ask, you know, right now, you can't turn on the news without hearing something about gun violence. The Most Honored Elijah Muhammad, of course, taught us not to carry as much as a penknife, you know, and we understand that, but we know that, you know, society as a whole are operating by some different rules. So tell me, what has, why is self-defense training so important in these times?
Well, you know, that's a very, very good question. And as a follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad under the Honorable Mr. Louis Farrakhan, I am one of those people who don't carry so much as a penknife. Mm-hmm. But I may have to get mine at the scene.
Yes, sir.
So understand that if I'm approached by someone, you know, my teacher taught me to have respect for everyone, even those who are coming at you with the threat of violence.
Right.
So if a guy comes at with to us with a knife or a gun and demands a wallet, you know, your money or your life, then your life means more than the money, right?
Yes, sir.
And so if you give up your wallet or your money, just make sure that you're giving it up out of respect for life, even the life of the person who is taking it from you, right?
Right.
However, if it's being motivated by just fear and allowing that person's weapon to become a god beside Allah, then it's not a good idea to give it up. And the second part of that would be if you feel that that's not gonna be enough. Like if I give this up and then they start looking around like they wanna just put two in you,
right?
Even though you gave them what they wanted, then you have to fight with those who fight with you.
Yes.
And you have to fight in the name of Allah. And you have to call on Allah. And that would be my cry in that moment if that were to happen to me. Mm-hmm. And so that's why it's so important, because everyone doesn't have a lawful firearm. And even those who have lawful firearms are not practicing every day, 3-4 days a week. They're not shooting. They're not firing off rounds. Mm-hmm. Like, we're in the dojo 3-4 days a week. How many times is a concealed carry licensed person going to the range and practicing shooting, practicing shooting under different scenarios, practicing, you know, their craft?
Right.
They're not. So what happens is you got this concealed carry license that's got dust on it, right?
Right.
And then you got this gun on your hip that got more dust on it, and then a situation arises and you probably forget you even have the gun, and or you now, because you're not comfortable, because you haven't been training with the weapon, it's going to be a very unnatural scenario for you. And then you might not even pull the weapon or get your weapon taken by the person who is doing something. So I think that self-defense training today is most important, because we teach our members, you are the knife.
Right.
You are the gun. You are the club. You are the real weapon. And so you'll find that a lot of times when people lose that weapon, they lose that God. That's that God in their hand. And if you can take it or disarm them, they may even run away, you know.
Yes,
so you gotta have some personal power. Mm-hmm. Your power can't be derived from a weapon. It has to derive from inside of you. So that's what self-defense and martial arts training does. It builds up the individual from the heart,
right,
the mind, and the body.
You know, I'm glad you said that, because you have to have the proper mindset. And you talk about the responsibility as well when you're learning martial arts or practicing, because if you're going into it, and this is more of a question because you're an expert with, okay, I just want to learn this skill so I could go out and I could beat up anybody. That's not what martial arts is for.
No, sir.
Oh, sir. And, you know, because when I listen to you, when I've listened to others who practice and study, the discipline and the mental aspect of it is huge. And it really seems like it has to go in line with the physical.
Yes, sir. It does. Mm-hmm. And you're right. Mm-hmm. It comes, you hear a lot of people say martial arts is 90% spiritual or mental and 10% physical. But how do you really make that draw that conclusion. Yes, it's because if I taught you 100 techniques, but I never built up your heart to use it, you just have 100 techniques that don't mean anything. Mm-hmm. You know, there are sometimes people with capability. I mean, think about how the enemy was able to master a larger person than them as the slaves and get them to conform and then ingrained in us. So now we just can't resist.
Yes,
we're just going to fall in.
Yes,
I mean, and but we probably were in it physically stronger and able to resist.
Yes,
but yet we didn't do anything. You know, you ever saw that movie Django?
Yes, sir.
And
yes, sir.
That scene in the movie where DiCaprio's character is talking about how this slave shaved his father every day for like 40 years, a straight razor on his neck,
right.
And it never entered his mind to just go zoop, you
yes,
know?
Sir.
And so if you have martial arts training, you have something inside you. It's like a buddy that's walking with you.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Powell would say you need that in the black community. You need a buddy walking with you. So that is, I hope I'm not going too far off of the point, but when we are giving you the lessons, we got to give you something else. So when we first come into the dojo, we get all the way down and we bow to the creator.
Mm-hmm.
Then we stand up. Everybody else, we stand up and bow. Mm-hmm. But then when we bow to each other, we're bowing to the God in each other.
Yes, sir.
Right? So we're recognizing the God in you, the God in me. That, you know, even if you don't believe in Allah and you're a Christian, like 98% of my school is Christian.
Yes, sir.
So I don't have a lot of the Muslims in my school. I have some, but
yes, sir.
They love me because I don't misrepresent where I'm from and I don't detract from where they say they are. And we all get along. But I always speak to the God in them. So I teach my students, you can. It's within you. It's your God potential. When the student first joins the school, Brother Jamil, I would say to them, I can teach a dog how to do this stuff, but you are greater than a dog would never be as great as you. So that you have the ability to pick and choose who's going to survive and who's going to not survive and encounter with you.
Mm-hmm.
Is it worth you going all the way? And I alluded to it in the interview I did last night about self-defense and the law. You got to be aware of how far you can go with what you know before it is no longer defense and it is now offense.
Yes,
and
sir.
Now you find yourself in a different scenario where you can't say I was acting out of self-defense, because once you incapacitate the person, obviously, and I know I'm being a little long-winded, Jamil, I don't mean to. Once you become aggressive, then it's not self-defense. And that's what we're hearing about in the news with the with the law enforcement officers who use those seven famous words, I was in fear for my life.
Yeah.
But then it becomes excessive, and now it's not fear. It's it's what is really the mind in you that makes you feel that 14 bullets is okay.
Yeah. You know, when you say that, and even for someone like you, now if you're trained as an expert, like, is that considered a weapon, technically? I mean,
it could be if I was asked the question, do you register? No, you don't register your hands. You don't do any of you register firearms.
Yes, sir.
That's what you you don't even have to register a machete. You register firearms. They have serial numbers on them, right?
Sir.
So you're saying I have this weapon and I have it lawfully and it's for my personal protection, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so if you come into my home and I have to discharge this firearm, you know, all my paperwork lines up that if I have a lawful shoot while you trying to do something to me in my house, I'm good. But it doesn't even require you to go and classify yourself as that. Anyone can be classified as that once your action is interrupted or you stop, and then you return to it while the other person is incapacitated.
Mm-hmm.
Now you acted using deadly force, whether you were registered or not.
How do you, for your new students, set, and I'm for a lack of a better term, realistic expectations or goals? So someone comes in, hey, I want to study this and I want to be a black belt. How long, with a dedicated commitment, do those things take? How do you set goals for, or help your students to set goals for themselves in that realm?
Well, you know what? Desire feeds the will.
Yes, sir.
If they come in and they are and they're committed, I was committed. Mm-hmm. You know, my path is not the ordinary path. Mm-hmm. But I was so in love with my teacher and what he was providing for me. I followed him around like a lost puppy that followed the new owner, right? I'm his shadow. I'm just right behind him. I'm carrying the bags. I'm traveling with him. I'm doing all of this stuff. That was my level of commitment. It was a struggle, too, because mm-hmm. I was on a very lean camel at the time.
Yes,
I wasn't flying out of town easy, like, yes, you know,
sir.
Just book me a ticket.
Yes,
but
sir.
My level of commitment took me from this stage to this stage to this very, very quickly.
Yes, sir.
Relatively quickly. I earned, most people takes them a while to get to green belt, which is like middle rank between white belt and black belt. Well, I got to green belt relatively quickly, in about 3-4 months. I earned the green belt. I earned the black belt in like just at like 4 years, maybe a little under mm-hmm. 4 years.
Okay.
And then 4 or 5 years later, I was promoted to mm-hmm. Fourth degree.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, then I spent a long time at fourth degree.
Yes, sir.
Before I got promoted to sixth degree. But, mm-hmm. you know, the time, it's just like, what is your level of commitment? You know, like my teacher would say, people quit everything. People quit, they do, don't they? They
yes,
quit
sir.
Jobs, they
yes,
quit
sir.
Relationships, they quit school. Mm-hmm. Quitting is common too, it's like an excuse. So. Is your word going to be your bond? If you say, I want a black belt, then you got to go through whatever trials and tribulations, push-ups, jumping jacks, sit-ups, all that stuff is a part of it. Mm-hmm. Are you going to let that knock you down from what you say you want? I want that black belt. Well, this is what's required of you. You got to bow to somebody. I know a lady, she could not get into the martial arts because she couldn't see herself bowing to anyone.
Mm.
Wow. That was amazing to me.
Yes.
Because her attitude about herself is that she is great and she really wants people to, mm-hmm. you know, look at her as right. something. But if you can't recognize the God in the next person, you know, it's reciprocal.
Yes,
you know,
sir.
we don't bow, like my students don't mm-hmm. bow to me, Brother right. Jamil, right. and I just stand up there and receive it. I have to right. bow back.
You know, brother, we have to do this again because it's so much more that we could talk about and so many layers to this, brother. I appreciate you coming on. I want you to take a few moments and speak to our viewing audience, tell them how they can contact you, the best way to contact you, and do you do seminars for corporate, like come out, maybe give 1 hour talks or any kind of talks on self-defense at all?
We absolutely do that.
Okay.
So
mm-hmm.
I guess I look here.
Yes, sir.
So for everyone who's interested in training directly with me, I'm at Martial Arts World. Our address is 16709 Torrance Avenue in Lansing, Illinois. Mm-hmm. Or you can train with me online at martialartsworldonline.com. Mm-hmm. We offer classes 4 days a week, Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, and Sundays. And we do offer seminars and corporate workshops and things like that. We will come in and work with your group, fraternity, sorority, and to help you guys, you know, get to where it is that you should like to want to be in your self-defense and your situational awareness. Thank you.
Thank you so much, brother, for joining me in this segment, okay?
Thank
All right.
you.
All right. Brothers and sisters, we're going to take a break, and we're going to come back with another interesting guest. We'll be right back.
Searching for a restaurant that serves delicious home-cooked meals at an affordable price like your grandmother used to make? Well, the search is over. Stop by MacArthur's, the new talk of Chicago. We offer a warm atmosphere with friendly service and excellent meals ranging from carryout, dine-in, or catering for your special events. MacArthur's is open 7 days per week from 11 a.m. until 9 p.m. Come visit us at
5412
West Madison Street or call us at 773-261-2316.
Thank you.
love you, Emma.
You are watching The Muneer Muhammad Show, a production of Crow. Please take time to join us at Crow, the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Crow is the National Archive of the Nation of Islam and houses one of the largest collections of historical audio, video, and print documentation on the total black experience. Crow is located at 2435 West 71st Street, the corner of 71st and Crow Lane. We are open 7 days a week, 9 to 5. Our number, 773-925-1600. We look forward to seeing you at Crow.
Eat and Run Chicken and Fish has the only chicken you can reheat and eat. It's good as mothers and better than the others. It is the chicken even mothers love. We've been serving the community for over 30 years. We cook with 100% vegetable oil and are open 7 days a week, including holidays. We're located at 87th and Hermitage. Contact us at 773-429-1812 for your takeout order, or let us provide all your catering needs. For the best chicken of your life, it's Eat and Run.
Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. We are back, and joining me in this segment is my friend and brother, the founder of Bean Soup Media. He's also a marketing strategist, and he is a realtor as well. It's our brother, Brother Tori Muhammad. Something like a brother.
Wa alaikum salam. How you doing,
brother? All right, brother. You're just an all-around entrepreneur, brother.
Man, we got to shake and move to yes, stay sir. Alive in this day and age.
Yes, sir, brother. I'll begin. You know, I know that you've been on the scene for quite some time, but for those who may not be familiar with you, just give them an overview of Bean Soup Media and all the services you provide, brother.
Yes, sir, man. I appreciate you, man. First, man, it's always a pleasure, man, to be in your presence and to be here in this, man, this historical platform, man,
that your
father built, man. It's just amazing and beautiful to see it continue to grow and flourish. So, man, I appreciate being here.
Thank you, brother.
And for what we do, you know, I say I do creative marketing and real estate work.
Yes,
right? We want to really solve problems. And the two problems that we've been able to build some experience, some knowledge, some network in has been in first marketing and foremost, right? I've been in that field in media marketing for about 27 years now. Of course, starting at the Final Call newspaper. And then just recently, about 2 years, roughly 2 years ago, I got my real estate license.
Yes, sir.
Right, so we're combining that with the marketing experience to focus on the two things that my community needs, which is to build generational wealth, right? It's real estate, home ownership, property ownership, and entrepreneurship, you know? Now, if we take those two, man, and we add the knowledge of self and the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, man, it's done. We
you know,
we got all we need.
You know, and the message taught us, you know, food, clothing, and shelter.
That's right.
You know?
That's right.
And when you look at the opportunity in real estate, because our people certainly need it, and it looks like that their property is available. And so, but tell me, what stimulated you to just go into that field?
Man, so I've always had an interest in real estate. I can recall, of course, there was a guy, as he was making a point about what the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad said about shelter and the importance of shelter, right? And those three you mentioned, food, clothing, and shelter. And he said that in other community, they're not considered a man until they own some property, right? That's a part of manhood. And we can say, you know, just of adulthood, whether male or female,
right?
So early on, I, you know, worked with a brother, and we flipped a home together. And then I used to work in different capacities with people in the real estate industry to help them market their business. And I was trying to really figure out how to work with a real estate agent to market, you know, houses that they have to sell. And I didn't ever seem to really get the best answer that I wanted from them.
Yes, sir.
You know, because I'm marketing, right? So I'm saying, look, pay me, I'll market the house for you. And so when I learned, I got into real estate as an agent and learned how you do have certain marketing tools set up, and the agent is not paid until the house is sold. So you don't have a lot of agents necessarily who have the upfront money
right.
to add additional marketing tools to, mm-hmm. you know, the traditional MLS and right. some of the things they have. Right. So I said, you know what, I'm going to go ahead and get my license and focus on that aspect that I really have wanted to do,
right.
which was to help people buy and sell. But really, really, I got into this because I see the opportunities to invest.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So now, because I have access, I have certain experience and knowledge I'm getting, mm-hmm. we're putting together a team of folks.
Right.
Right. That can help people through the whole process. Mm-hmm. And we're going to go through the process.
That's right.
Right. I'm starting to invest mm-hmm. in real estate. And then we want to show our community how, when we see the opportunities in our neighborhoods with distressed buildings, mm-hmm. distressed property, but you have people who need a place to live.
Right.
Let's work this out, yeah. right? And we can have some places and spaces that we control, mm-hmm. that we can provide the needs of the community and, mm-hmm. and for ourselves as well.
Have you found it a bit challenging to convince our people that they're capable of owning? Because sometimes, you know, we might have a renter's mentality, think, oh, well, my credit is not this. You know, we defeat ourselves before we even explore.
Absolutely. Yeah. And it comes in two categories, right? Exactly. You have the people who feel they can't financially afford it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's they don't realize that they're paying $2,000 a month in rent, mm-hmm. and they can have a mortgage that might be $1,000.
Right. Right.
Maybe mm-hmm. even when you include interest and taxes, it may be mm-hmm. $1,500.
Yeah.
Right. So
yes.
you're going to pay less for a mortgage sometimes than you're paying right. for rent. But sometimes our people, they don't want that responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
They may feel they financially can handle it, but they're like, look, I'm going to have to do this. I'm going to have to mm-hmm. make sure if this breaks. Some of them are comfortable right. knowing that if something breaks, they can rely on somebody else to do it. And they think that it's going to be more of an expense for them to do it themselves. But mm-hmm. so we're going to do, God willing, inshallah, we're going to do some home buyer seminars.
Okay.
And we're going to demystify and break down some of those things and show them the possibilities mm-hmm. of it. And, you know, for some people, the reality may be that you may not be ready to go to that big single family dream home that
right.
you want, because that's the other thing.
Right.
Right. We have in our minds what we know that we deserve. And it's that 5-bedroom, right?
Right.
A bath, you know, mm-hmm. 6 baths and a pool.
Right.
Right. And
right.
and mm-hmm. there's some stages, right?
Yes,
so
sir.
Let's get you in the 4-flat first.
Yeah.
Right? Let you own that, which sometimes can be the same amount of money, but you got 3 other people helping you to pay
right,
off that
right.
mortgage,
yes,
right?
Sir.
And then mm-hmm. maybe your second one or your third home is your dream home.
Yes, sir.
But and that's the way when you look at some of the history of Chicago, that mm-hmm. was the platform.
Right.
Right. You mm-hmm. have a lot of our 3 and 4 flats, some of those 2 flats mm-hmm. were built by, you know, Polish and Croatian mm-hmm. families that came
right.
here and started building. They came from the big apartment buildings.
Mm-hmm.
They got them a 2 or 3 flat that they either bought a blueprint for and built mm-hmm. it themselves, or they paid somebody to
right.
do it. And then they went from the 3 flat after that was paid mm-hmm. down a little bit, and they got that bungalow.
Yes, sir.
Right, which yeah. was the dream home, right?
Yeah.
And they started moving out further west from the mm-hmm. from the inner city.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a platform. It's a blueprint that's there, mm-hmm. that if we understand the principle, mm-hmm. we can follow those same steps.
I know you said you're putting together a team, and I know you're making new connections. Is there opportunity for investment property where you could refer contractors to kind of do the work to finish it once you purchase? Because see, that's another thing. Some people may want to do it, but they don't know the contractors and
that's
people
right.
to do the work to
that's right.
get it livable.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. So mm-hmm. with us being able to show properties for mm-hmm. different investors, we mm-hmm. are building up a database of contractors. Right. We are working with a few different lenders.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And I think we got one that there's some opportunities, I think, to work with them long term.
Yeah.
But, you know, there are a lot of lenders out there. You have traditional and then you have private lenders
mm-hmm.
and the private lenders, you know, they oftentimes can offer you the same type of loans that your conventional, your FHA mm-hmm. And VA loans. But they're just doing it specifically for people who want to invest.
Right.
Right. So those opportunities are there. So we want to make sure that we have a group of good lenders mm-hmm. to refer our investors to, contractors.
Mm-hmm.
And it is, man, that's one of the biggest, you know, hurdles. If you get that right contractor that can come in there and fix up that property for you. And what I'm beginning to learn is that if you find a contractor who also invests, not that just has a business where they're fixing up property, but they are investing in properties themselves. So now they know how to fix up your property quality, but not for the price that it would take if, you know, you got some contractors, their specialty is a real blinged out jacuzzi.
Right.
Well, if you are buying and investing in property to rent out, you're not going for the jacuzzi.
You
just want a good solid bathroom.
Yes, sir.
Where that's going to be solid and, you know, that somebody would want to rent out. So you got to find that good investor type contractor. So when we find somebody that's also investing, we want to really, give them some attention and make sure we build that good relationship, then you got your property manager. Preferably. Now, of course, if somebody's just only thinking about getting one or two properties, they might not need a property manager. But if you're looking, you know, to make this a part of that retirement opportunity, where you got, you know, 20, 30, 40 properties, then you want a good property manager that's going to manage all that for you. Because that's the other thing, even when it comes to somebody investing in that three flat, they say, well, I don't want to get up in the middle of the night because somebody's toilet is stopped up.
Exactly.
Well, you got your property manager, you built that into your rent and everything, and have them handle all that.
Yeah, that's a big piece. You know, as we wind down in this segment, quickly, like, we know that inflation is here, right? So I know it was a seller's market, but what do you say to the people that are a little intimidated about making a commitment right now?
Right. Well, it's slowing down. It's still kind of a seller's market, but it's stalling.
Okay.
Right.
All right.
And it may start to level off, but how soon or how fast it becomes a buyer's market is questionable.
Right.
Right. It may be not till next year because while it's been a seller's market because there are more people who want to buy than want to sell, now people are slowing down on buying.
Yeah.
So even though, you know, so now you don't have as many properties that are moving fast and moving for a higher price than what they're asking for it, because the interest rates are going up. So now people are buying a little bit more. They ain't as frantic as they were, you know, 6 months or a year ago.
Right.
So it's starting to level off. But, you know, what I encourage people to do is you focus on what makes the most sense and what you need to do based upon what your time schedule is. Because it's not necessarily no good or right time to buy for everybody. Even during the seller's market, I was able to negotiate some contracts that was below the asking price, but it was only that property.
I couldn't do that for every situation.
So each situation is different. So you got to be able to, you know what your options are, know what the opportunities are. But, you know, it's always a good time to purchase some real estate because at the end of the day, you're building something that you're going to have that's your own. You know, in most situations, the property is going to appreciate.
Right.
And you're spending the money anyway.
Yes.
If you're living somewhere, you're still spending that money. So why not have it go towards something that you own?
All praise is due to Allah, brother. Well, what I want you to do, if someone is interested in not only your services for real estate, but we'll start there. But how can they reach out and contact you?
They can call me at 773-531-8798. 773-531-8798.
And even though in this particular show, we didn't get to talk about the marketing as much. Is that the same number if they want to talk to you?
Absolutely.
Okay, because not only can you help them acquire property, you can help advertise for the renters.
That's right. That's right.
All that, brother. Okay.
Absolutely. Well,
brother, you know, I want to applaud and salute you, brother. I've known you for quite some time, and you're always working on the program for independence, you know, and you exemplify that with what you do And may Allah continue to bless you, brother. That's wonderful work that you're doing, helping our people, brother.
Man, thank you, man. And, I appreciate you.
You know, it's nice to be recognized and the people you're doing a great work in our with
yes,
our
sir.
People, okay?
Yes, sir. Thank All you. Right. Appreciate you.
Thank you. Brothers and sisters, I hope you enjoyed today's broadcast, and I encourage you to visit us at CRO, www.cre.org, to find out more about what we do as far as the National Archives for the Nation of Islam, as we defend and represent, preserve the name, teachings, and accomplishments of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Give us a call at 773-925-1600. On behalf of the CRO Television production team, I'm the host, Jamil Muhammad, leaving you with the greetings of peace and paradise. Assalamu alaikum.